Good afternoon. It's Thursday, the 23rd of July 2015, just after 1 o'clock, and welcome to UK Column News. I'm your host this afternoon, Brian Gerrish. With me in the studio behind the technical desk is Nick Green, and we're very pleased to say we're going to be joined shortly by Mickey Summers, child abuse survivor from Nottingham, and he's delighted to have his wife Lorraine with him today. And Mickey and his wife will be giving us an update on what's been happening around the child abuse issue in Nottingham. Before we start today, we'll just say a few words on the weather. Not too good. So it's been pretty overcast. Cloudy here in Plymouth. I think it's much the same across the rest of the country with odd spots of rain, although one or two places have apparently seen the a peep of sunshine. Well, where shall we start today? We thought we would come straight in with a look at Nottingham. And first of all, just this short article, which is from the Nottingham Post, talking about the residents around Tom Crawford's former home, as they say. Tom Crawford, of course, was recently unlawfully evicted and his home taken. But it now appears that his neighbours are getting increasingly upset with the fact that they're now living in a high security area, and they are complaining that the actions of the private security company that's been called in to literally ring fence Tom Crawford's old house, the security services with their dogs and the CCTV cameras, they're calling a surveillance state. And we also know that the police in Nottingham have been particularly brutal and aggressive when dealing with members of the public who've come forward to try and help Tom Crawford and his wife and prevent that eviction. This is just an incredible piece of film footage that was taken when a few of Tom Crawford's supporters decided they would walk a few hundred yards to the local pub to have a beer and expressed their support for the landlord, who understood also supported Tom Crawford. In this remarkable film footage by Mark Salon, we will start to see the reality of Britain's police turning into what must be a vicious private army. Just have a look at this.
That it's only 5 minutes up the hours. Why don't we go up there, walk up there, those who can walk, and buy a pint in there to show that the support they've given Tom and Sue, and we'll come back, pick our vehicles up or whatever, okay? But I think that would be a physical statement.
Yes.
Now all this because we're going on a pub crawl. Look, armed police. Ah, you muppets! More armed response! Armed response because you're going for a beer, it's ridiculous! So what's happened, Sue?
Well, we've come out of the pub to come up to the Elwes just as a thank you, because obviously normally we would be able to come up to our local.
Yeah.
And we've had to hold the meeting because obviously Tom's been charged with a false assault on a police officer. Charge, and he's obviously got a restraining order on him, which obviously again is totally and utterly unlawful and illegal, if you want to say that word. We've come up just for a walk up to the Elwes, as I said, and we've had this police response, which is totally and utterly out of context.
Now, I noticed there was some black unmarked cars. As far as I'm aware, they're an armed response.
I personally don't know.
An armed response vehicle.
Yeah.
Because that was one of the vehicles that came to us at County Hall.
Mm.
You know, so we've just come for a wander, because obviously this is where we normally have our our meetings. So just wanted to, you know, say thank you.
So this is dictatorship Nottingham then, where if you're going on a pub crawl, the police send armed response out to make sure you do as you're told.
It looks like that, doesn't it?
Interesting.
I mean, you know, it's totally and utterly unbelievable, actually. I mean, we called out somebody to come and look, somebody shot a pigeon outside our house last year. It took 4 or 5 days to get somebody around, and then we got a PCO.
Well,
and that was shooting a pigeon at our door.
Well, you see, that's a totally different matter to that the banks don't like.
Yeah, well, obviously, but I mean, these people are just out for an enjoyable afternoon and come to the meeting and have a wander up to the Elwes.
Well, yeah, and that's what I was thinking. I came out, started walking up, and all these cars flying by with the lights blaring, and
I thought there'd been a murder somewhere.
Out of the pub.
Yeah, but so, yeah, I mean, you know, it speaks for itself, I think.
I think it does. Now, go and get a well-earned drink.
I will do.
More scum.
Oh. Hello.
Hiya.
Yes, lads.
What's going on, lads? I've been in the pub and I've seen all you lot up here from nowhere. Can you tell me what's going on?
No.
Oh, okay.
I asked you not to come down here then.
Why?
Why?
You're a resident.
You're a resident.
What's that got to do with you?
He's not.
You're not a resident.
What's it got to do with you?
Well, you're not to come past this point. Right,
what says I can't get past this point?
Why? Because if you do, then I perceive there's likely to be a breach of the peace.
There's no breach of the peace.
Okay.
So what is going on?
I'm not informing you of that. I'm just telling you that I don't want you to.
So,
can I
rotate what my colleagues are
against? Can I see your identity? Mm. So, this is the sort of dictatorship we live in today then? Can't even go for a beer.
We went through all this the other day, didn't we? A couple of days ago.
Oh, you were one of the sickos that were here.
Right, I'm a sicko, am I?
Yeah.
Right, okay.
You, can you tell him what you did wasn't sick?
Are you telling me that what I did was?
Yes.
Why?
You ain't no better than a criminal offence.
Right, okay. That's what you think I did?
I know that's what you did.
Right, okay.
Did you get any paperwork? Did you see any paperwork? Or you just followed orders?
Me too.
So what went on in the court? You tell me.
I don't need to tell you. You seem to know have all the answers.
Okay.
So where's the paperwork? Is there any paperwork? Oh, they're that organised. You've even lost the van keys now. Wow. So. Committed here. Constable, I do believe you're a public servant. Has there been a crime committed here? I can see you're young and you probably wish you weren't here, and you're rightly, you shouldn't really be here. But there seems to be a tape across this road that suggests something's gone off here. Has there been a crime committed? As you don't know the answer, I'll give you the answer. The answer is yes, you've committed it.
Well, there we are. What an incredible video clip. And I can tell from comments coming into the UK column chat box that people are pretty astonished to see the sheer scale of the police force employed against ordinary members of the public who've previously been peacefully protesting, but were simply going down the road to have a beer. And what do we see? Not only a large number of police cars and policemen and women, but of course we've also got armed response units. This is in addition to the simple taser armed policemen, we've got armed response units, and I understand that there are also helicopters present. So Nottingham Police unable to fully investigate and stop child abuse, but when it comes to protecting courts handling what are clearly unlawful documents and allowing private bailiffs companies to literally come and take somebody's house without the necessary court documents, just as many assets as you like. This is the state of Britain's police across the country. We're focusing on Nottingham today because, of course, we want to deal with Mickey Summers on the issue of child abuse in Nottingham. What else have Nottingham's police been up to? Well, we're sorry to say that yesterday, their officers rearrested child abuse survivor Melanie Shaw. And about 5:30 yesterday afternoon, we understood, following a call from Mickey himself, that Melanie had been arrested in a public place in Nottingham. And we can now tell you that currently she is held in the Bridewell custody suite in Nottingham. And we understand that aside from being questioned by Nottingham police, there are also officers travelling from Cambridge to interview Melanie. We'll come on to that a bit more in a moment. Who's the chief police officer? Of course, responsible for the despicable behaviour of Nottingham police at the moment. Well, let's introduce him. It's this gentleman, Mr. Chris Eyre. And what we now know is that following a secret closed-door MAPA meeting in Nottingham, for those of you who don't know, this is the highly secretive multi-agency public protection arrangement. At a secret meeting, Melanie Shaw was designated as a serious and dangerous criminal. And this meant that she could be hunted by not only police, but local authority sources, mental health sources, National Health Service sources, right the way across the country through any one of the, I believe, 63 in total MAPA areas. So this is not a joke. This is not 1984. This is David Cameron's Conservative Britain in 2015. Unlimited police resources at a time of austerity, which can be used to track and hunt down a child abuse survivor, Melanie Shaw, wherever she is in the country. And of course, it isn't just Nottingham police that have been on her trail. Devon and Cornwall police hammering on the door of the UK column to try and find her only a few days ago. And then following her move to a location in Peterborough, Cambridgeshire police also on the trail of Melanie Shaw. And we've had our own experience with Devon and Cornwall police. Others have seen the actions of Nottingham police, but even the Cambridgeshire police turned up in force to see whether they could speak to Melanie Shaw. Two female officers up front and two male heavies sat in a police car. Why are the police so terrified of this young lady? Why is the British establishment so terrified of this young lady? It is because of the knowledge in her head about the serious sexual abuse of a large number of youngsters at Beechwood Children's Home in Nottingham. And of course, Melanie Shaw has stated on several occasions that she believes that children were murdered. To date, we see no positive results from Operation Daybreak. That's supposedly the Nottinghamshire Police investigation. So at the moment, Melanie Shaw is in this custody suite. And we were staggered to see when we went looking for a picture, we find that local students have been taken there by part of the civil service. And what are they doing with these youngsters? Well, I think they're reframing them, because clearly the three in the cell, we can see A19, seem to think that the whole process is a joke. You can have a look at this yourself if you go on gov.uk, look up civil service local, showing students how the justice system works. So the justice system cannot find the paedophiles, it can't find the people abusing children, it can't find the paedophiles in Westminster, but what the justice system can do is track down a highly vulnerable child abuse victim, Melanie Shaw, and ensure that she's incarcerated in what looks to be a pretty bleak type of cell. Well, let's contrast that with where Justice Goddard is at the moment, because this New Zealand judge, of course, has been paid, or is being paid, somewhere around £500,000 a year, plus allowances, a smart office, a smart family home, airfares back to New Zealand. And this is the lady who is claiming she is carrying out an independent inquiry into child sexual abuse. We decided to call the helpline, which is top left of that website, in order to ask a simple question. Can you tell us what help the helpline provides? Well, we were astonished when the gentleman who answered the call said he couldn't speak to us. And we would have to talk to the inquiry media team. So we patiently waited while at least 5 minutes of motivating music was played in our ears. And then we got in touch with the inquiry media officer. To our utter astonishment, he told us that media and the helpline was not dealt with by the inquiry team. It was actually being dealt with by none other than the NSPCC. We pointed out that this meant that, of course, the inquiry is not independent in any way. What we have here is, as far as we're concerned, is yet another scam by the Home Office and Theresa May, that we're being told there's an independent inquiry, which isn't. I think at this point we should bring in Mickey Summers. Mickey, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here today, Brian.
Okay, well, I hope you're able to just hear those points that we've run through. What's your reaction?
As I said to you last night when I was on the phone to you, I was actually on the phone with Melanie when the police got a hold of her. It was quite a traumatic arrest. And, you know, they really don't care. At the end of the day, all they're interested in doing is closing down people or exposing people. It was expected that she was going to be hauled in. But I'd like to take you back to July the 1st, just after you spoke to David Hollis, the chair of our inquiry action group. We were scheduled to go into the county council and city council and police meeting to structure a public inquiry. Now, when we were, David went in on July the 1st, he was told that there's not going to be a public inquiry. We've got Paddy Tipping on video saying that we've got the inquiry. Now, this has been directed by Helen Chamberlain, the woman that Melanie's meant to have harassed, which is the reason why she was arrested yesterday. But it goes way beyond Superintendent Helen Chamberlain, because she's the one that oversees everything for Operation Daybreak. But Chris Eyre is the beast of Nottingham. He's a man of failure, a failure from Leicester Police. What do Leicester Police have a responsible for? The McCann inquiry, Jammer. You know, failures follow that man wherever he goes, and he's failing in Nottingham. 5 years of Operation Daybreak, and what have we got? No one brought to trial, not one conviction, untold millions of pounds of taxpayers' money for what? All they're doing is protecting paedophiles. I'll cite my case of coming back from America. Prior to coming back, I was told that Nottinghamshire Police had tried on numerous occasions to liaise via Interpol to speak to me on a video link. Chief of Police Jim Shepherd is on record, and he's the Chief of Police of the City of Rochester, New York, on record as saying no one from Nottingham contacted them. They didn't want my evidence, just the same as they don't want Melanie's. But they did tell me if I came back, they'd need to actually re-interview me. Now, I came back on April the 3rd, and it wasn't until Nick Frame at the Mansfield Chad put headline news, "Find my rapist before I do," that I was actually brought in to be actually interviewed by a UK officer for the first time in 18 months into that investigation. Thoroughly disgusting. And I had to go and batter on the door of the Nottingham Police via Twitter, via Facebook, via protests, to eventually get an interview. Why? Because at the end of the day, I have documentary proof that they're hiding paedophiles. Nottingham City Council claimed that a certain regional director did not exist. It was a figment of my imagination until I pulled up court documents from the archives that they claimed to have searched. Also, medical records that they had access to that placed me in a children's home that didn't exist. But Paddy Tipping goes one better, the Crime Commissioner, because he identifies him as being the boss for the city and the county council, the regional director of social services. It goes way beyond the heads of departments at the city of Nottingham and the county of Nottinghamshire. We believe it goes to Westminster, but there's allegations that I'm not going to go into for current legal reasons at the moment. And at the end of the day, we believe it does go to Westminster and Dolphin Square and all the rest of it. We're not going to stop. We're going into We're going to go in and see Paddy Tipping again next week. Paddy Tipping, we don't believe he's sitting on the fence at this time. We believe that he's disgusted at the attitude of the councils. But I'm actually going to call for the dismissal of Chris Eyre and Superintendent Helen Chamberlain as being not fit for office. Me and David Hollis recently went in with a complaint about Superintendent Chamberlain dismissing a phone call from me. She slammed the phone down on me. She did not want to enter into dialogue. And via a professional standards complaint, myself and David Hollis went in to be interviewed over it. They don't want to look at the big picture. The only thing they want to look at is the fact that she slammed the phone down on me. Well, I'm sorry, Superintendent Jeb, who did the interview, you're not fit for office too. In fact, I'd say most of the hierarchy of the Nottinghamshire Police Force are not fit for office. In the words of Jeremy Carr, I think they should all go and do one, you know, because at the end of the day, we are going to come and we're going to keep coming and coming and coming, right? We're not going to stop. And if we have to take this all the way to Brussels and the European Court for Human Rights, we're going all the way. We're not going to stop. And as for Chris Eyre, well, your days are numbered. John Collins, the head of the City Council and your chief executive in Korea, the head of Social Services, Alistair Michalska, your days are numbered too, because we're not going to stop.
Okay.
You stick an injunction where the sun doesn't shine. That also is a fraudulent document, just like the ones that are issued to Tom Crawford. No judge's signature, and I will be in court, and I'll be challenging it. And if need be, I will arrest the judge for trying to put me on trial for what I see as them being the criminals.
Mickey, I'm going to say to you, I'm sure many people, UK Column included, are saying to you, well done for what you're doing and the fact you are sticking to your guns over this. Let me just pick up on what you've mentioned there, that you're sure that this goes to the highest level. Let's bring in a couple of the headlines, because, of course, we've now got the government finally admitting, yes, of course, there were dossiers warning that there were paedophiles operating at the heart of government. Let's have a look at a couple of those headlines and then we'll come back to you again. So we've chosen this. It happens to be the Daily Mail, which is a local newspaper for the UK column. It's southwest of England. Here we are. MI5 warned Thatcher government over a sea of abuse claims. Spy chiefs warned the Thatcher government allegations an MP had a penchant for small boys. It risked causing political embarrassment. But this is the interesting point. Child abuse investigators found no consideration had been given to the threat to children the politicians posed. But MI5 had warned senior officials that the accusations could be dangerous for the administration. So no care or consideration for the victims. All they were worried about was protecting the reputation of senior political figures. Absolutely disgraceful. And if you didn't pick it up at the bottom of the screen, there are just the names that this article specifically mentioned. There we are. We've got Leon Britton, Peter Morrison, Sir Peter Heyman, and former minister, I think that's Sir William von Strobenzee. And we're not just talking about one individual. We've already got a small ring of these child abusers at the heart of government. The security services knew. What did they do? Nothing. So we can now see for ourselves that British security services knew about the paedophiles operating at the heart of government and they did nothing. Why am I particularly motivated on this subject? Well, like many other people. I served my time in the British military while I was doing my job, thinking I was defending my country. What was happening within my own government was disgraceful, perverted behaviour, and of course, a lie, a continuous lie by British security services to cover up the widespread abuse of children. Well, let's bring in the Daily Record. Obviously, the Red Tops get a lot of flack about their style of reporting. But if I look back over the years, it's been journalists from the Red Tops that have been the people that have got closest to exposing this until they were, of course, closed down. So here we are with the Daily Record Child Sex Abuse Inquiry. Here he is, Leon Britton, amongst leading Westminster figures named in the documents. The former Tory Home Secretary's name is on government file, along with other more powerful Westminster officials during the 1970s and 80s. Sky News said that after months of requests, Whitehall has finally revealed that papers do exist. So here's the usual routine. The British government, doesn't matter whether it's Tory, Lib Dem or Labour, lying and blocking the release of papers which could help bring countrywide paedophile rings to justice. And it's taken Tom Watson here in this article. Of course, he's been widely campaigning against child abuse. And he accuses the government of sneaking out the documents during the parliamentary recess. And he says that it meant the MPs could not scrutinise properly, couldn't scrutinise the papers, nor hold ministers to account. So this is deliberate propaganda by the British government in order to deceive the public once again, and indeed to protect paedophiles. Well, Sky News also on the case here. And it's bringing in ex-head of MI5, child abuse cover-up. Well, we don't need an allegation because the evidence is in front of our eyes. They did nothing. Britain Security Services clearly involved in the covering up of child abuse. And that brings us into the subject of King Cora Boys Home, where senior military people have consistently said that MI5 was using the abuse of boys in order to blackmail people into doing their bidding. Well, the Russians are on the case. I can imagine that President Putin is is smiling to himself as he looks at the sheer filth being exposed in the British government in 2015. So here's Sputnik: leaked docs prove MI5 covered up for paedophiles among Thatcher's government. We're in 2015, and of course we simply haven't got any change. But I just want to get people thinking about this report. Sky News cited a spokesman from a children's rights lobby group, the National Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Children, that should be NSPCC, who said the disclosure showed how people at the highest levels of government simply weren't thinking about crimes against children. And I'm going to say, question: is this lack of concern about the abuse of children due to the government nudging the public to believe it's all in the past and of no concern today? Well, Mickey, that is pretty damning evidence coming into the mainstream press. Of course, what the government's trying to tell us is, don't worry, all the abuse is in the past. But you are somebody who absolutely knows that's not true. And of course, that's why you've been putting the effort into Nottingham. So if you will, just explain to us again, there was an inquiry being set up that was going to be survivor led. And you told us originally that Nottingham City Council was quite interested in that idea. Now, I think what you're saying is that all of that's been closed down. Is that correct?
Myself and the retired Army Colonel David Horst, who you've spoken to before, and other members of the CSA Action Group, we were actually in a meeting with Mark Solano, who videoed it. And Paddy Tipping said that the force and the two councils have agreed to a survivors-led inquiry. But a whistleblower from the council said they're going to stab you in the back, and they're going to cause a delay, and they're going to start a review. All a review will do is say, well, we screwed up, right? But current safeguardings are all okay, and we move forward. That's what they've done for over 60 years, Brian, and we're not having it no more. You know, it's time to clear the decks and have a full, open inquiry. And even the likes of those that still work for the councils that have been involved in the cover-up, they are criminals and they need to be brought to court for acts of malfeasance and gross professional misconduct. I've got a catalogue that will go to the Goddard Inquiry of abuses put upon me by both councils and the Nottinghamshire Police. Chris Hare, well, he needs to be on before Judge Goddard too, but hopefully, God willing, it will happen.
Mickey, what's your thoughts about the Goddard Inquiry? Because as I've just explained, I now know that it is not independent at all, because it's basically part of NSPCC. I've had a number of abuse survivors come to me talking about their deep concerns about people who have historically been working in NSPCC. This organisation as a charity, my personal opinion, seems to have consistently failed children. It says it's there doing the job of protecting them, but NSPCC has been going for years. And apparently NSPCC has never had a child victim come forward who's ended up talking about paedophiles being embedded in Westminster or the establishment. I simply can't believe this. Do you trust Goddard? Do you trust NSPCC?
I had limited faith that, you know, the structure of the inquiry on paper looks good. But you're just throwing a spanner in the works with what you've come up with the NSPCC. What I am aware of is the work that White Flowers have done in terms of some of the meetings that we've had in Parliament discussing the way forward for this inquiry. And we're privileged that we've got Nigel O'Mara from White Flowers here in Nottingham, who's worked alongside us, and he has quite a bit of faith that the Goddard Inquiry will eventually get what we need. But at the moment, my personal view is that the scope of that inquiry does not have a broad enough spectrum. But it's early days yet, and she said in her opening speech that whether it be anyone from the establishment, be they ministers, heads of departments, she doesn't care who they are, they will be brought to book. And we just have to see if she lives up to that billing.
Okay. Now, Mickey, you told me that your wife, Lorraine, was with you today. And one of the things that you've mentioned, of course, is for any child abuse survivor, it's particularly the support of their family members that gets them through the hard times. And, of course, that it's family members that also bear a large part of the suffering. Your wife is there today. She's just flown in from the States. Would she like to say a few words on camera? I think so. Just bear with us while there's a little bit of setting up of the CCTV. Hello, Lorraine. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Can you hear me?
I can. Yes, you're loud and clear. I'm going to say thank you very much for just agreeing to come on live. It makes such a difference when people can see real people, real personalities. And Mickey was very keen to that you were able to say a few words for yourself. How? What can I ask you, which is easy to deal with? What can you say? What has it been like being a family member for a child abuse victim? How does it affect other members of the family?
It's been hell, to put it bluntly. Even when they're not there with you. 24/7, even in sleep, they wake up from dreams. It's a never-ending battle, and it's made me feel insignificant and unwanted, not important enough. I mean, Nottingham councils have taken my husband away, and I'm not a happy camper. So, I don't know. What else do you want to ask me?
Well, that is a very clear response that you've given, that it's been hell, basically. We have had enough contact with child abuse survivors to see that very often there's big mood swings. And that can be really quite difficult to deal with. On a positive note, do you think that there is some progress now in the fact that truth information is coming up to the surface? Do you think that something can be done to root these people out from the establishment?
Yes, I do. Now that there's been more media coverage, because there's more support now. And with more support is more strength. And there's always strength in numbers. And thanks to the media exposure, we're beginning to see a light at the end of the tunnel.
Right. That's really excellent. And just one last question. Are people in the States aware of what started to happen, that we are now exposing that the British government has been involved in the abuse of children and certainly covered up the abuse of children? Is that knowledge coming to the American public at the moment, or are they still unaware?
For the most part, they're unaware. The mainstream is unaware, but every chance I get every day, at least once a day, I have to tell somebody about it. And I, you know, post on social media and email and make phone calls. And everybody that says, why is your husband 3,800 miles away? I say, well, you can thank Nottingham for that. And then I proceed to tell them the story.
Yeah. Okay. Well, okay. Lorraine, thank you very much for telling us that. And I hope you have time to recover from that flight. And
thank you.
And some time to enjoy England as well. It isn't all bad. Mickey, a last comment from you, if you like. And, of course, we'll be speaking to you again.
Yeah, well, just as they've done to Tom Crawford, taking his house with fraudulent documents, I have that fraudulent injunction. It's been examined by Guy Taylor and a forensic document examiner. And there's no judge's signature, there's no seal. So if the judge wants to go ahead with a trial, he'll be attempting to pervert the course of justice, and he will be arrested. As for John Collins, Courier, Machowska, Steve Edwards, Alan Rhodes, and this new guy at the helm at Nottinghamshire County Council, you can all go and do one. I'm coming for you, and so is the rest of Nottingham. We will get justice in the end. As for Melanie Shaw, she too will not be silenced, because whatever you do to her, we will still be there behind her as her voice. And for everyone else that's still to come forward, we will be your voice and we will make sure you're heard.
Brilliant. Mickey and Lorraine, thank you very much for joining us. A few more parts of the news to cover, but keep at it and we will stay in touch. Thanks very much.
And we have a protest tomorrow in Nottingham on the Victoria Embankment from 1 o'clock.
Okay, Victoria Embankment, Nottingham, 1 o'clock protest. Anybody who can actually travel and be there, I'm sure Mickey and his team will be delighted to see you. Thanks, Mickey. I'll just also remind people that on Monday, Robert Green, who has campaigned so hard to protect children from abuse, and of course, he is particularly campaigned for justice for Holly Gregg. A court case taking place where former Procurator Fiscal Eilish Angelini is attempting to claim court costs from Robert. Robert is refusing to engage with this case because he maintains that the money she received initially came from the public purse. This is a very interesting state of affairs. Robert Green has still not received written court documents spelling out in detail what the draconian gagging order was. At the moment, he has simply been told in that original court hearing he is not allowed to speak on the subject of Holly Gregg anywhere in the world on any medium to any person. Neither is he allowed to speak out on the matter of child abuse, even if a child comes to him for help because they are being abused. So what is happening north of the border, quite clear, another massive cover-up of establishment child abuse. So frightened is the Scottish government, they need a gagging order on Robert Green for life in order to stop him exposing the abuse of Holly Gregg. Well, if we have a look at what else is happening in the country, no better place to go than Google. Of course, Google is the company that could stop internet pornography literally at the flick of a switch. But what is Google up to? Well, they think they should be taking over libraries. And the Birmingham Post here saying that Google has offered to boost a troubled library in Birmingham. And they're going to set up what they're calling a garage. So we are going to be changing from knowledge from books to Google actually running what they're calling libraries. And as Mike Robinson and others have been pointing out over a number of years, what happens when the internet companies get hold of information? Well, the truth seems to get lost or distorted. If you're not aware, many, many libraries have been closing down throughout the UK. This is all coming under these fraudulent austerity cuts. But when the libraries go, so do the books, of course, and so does the real source of knowledge and, in many cases, history. Well, the Mirror picked up on this as well. They tweeted out, perhaps appropriately, a big eye. And they're talking here on the fact that Google has now got an application which can sit on your phone and record everywhere you go, every step of your life. And it then will plot it out on a timeline. This is supposed to be convenient for us, but of course what it really does is allows the surveillance state to follow every step we make. Well, we can track the public, but we can't get to grips to people like Tony Blair. The Daily Mail here, is this an article mocking him or supporting him? Difficult to tell. Tony Blair talking to the faithful. And we say, what is this man about? Unlawful wars, death and destruction, lies and cover-up, obscene wealth, violence and death in the Middle East. And now we're to be subjected to his views on politics. Go away, Mr. Blair, and await your call for the International Court for War Crimes. Well, if there's spin in the mainstream press, of course there's spin in the BBC. And if you haven't seen it yet, have a look at our interview with Ian Puddick, where he shows how the BBC deliberately misled the public over his own case, and in particular the action of the City of London Police, which spent somewhere between £1.5 million and £3 million in what was essentially a civil action. Just a slight pause at the moment. Okay, we've just come back on screen. Have a look for that, and that interview will run immediately after the news. What is the BBC doing? Well, the BBC thinks at the moment that the government's nudge programme is something we should all be very grateful for. So this is the BBC News report. Politicians learn the power of using nudge technique. And reporter Mark Easton is seen in this video, which I encourage people to go and watch. Mr. Easton is grinning and smirking, and he says some people think this is all a bit sinister, the government getting into their getting into people's heads and changing their behaviour. And Mr. Halpin from the Government Behavioural Insights team, this is the unit using applied psychology to change the way we think and behave, completely ignores the question about it being sinister. He just says, well, it's working, so we need to do more of it. But follow through the video and you'll come across this man. This is the founder of an asset management company. So we're into big money, Mr. Tyler. And while this man's being interviewed, what actually happens is that the background music changes to what I instantly recognised, which was the children's music that was played when Tony Hart, the cartoonist, used to draw pictures. So as this interview goes on, the music in the background is all very calm. It's all rather good fun. It's all a little bit childish. And the deliberate and misleading BBC message is that the work of the government applied behavioural psychology unit is all a bit of innocent fun. Well, what sort of BBC reporter would get up to this? Well, here's the man. Have a look at his Twitter page, Mark Easton. And if you have a look on that page, he's boasting how it's been the BBC that's reported the nudging unit. So lots of self-adulation there. And this is the gentleman that he was very happy to big up, Richard Taylor, author of Misbehaving, the Making of Behavioural Economics. If you look on Wikipedia, you can see the details that he was founder of the asset management firm Fuller and Taylor Asset Management. So we're into big money and banking. And what the BBC is really doing here is promoting this asset management founder to make more money, because he's got a book out. But what's it about? Well, how we can take more money from people in taxes using a bit of nudging. Where's that money going? To the corrupt international banking system that hedge funds and such like are dipping into in the first place. So this is either total ignorance from Mark Easton or something else. But it was, in fact, the UK column back in 2010 that exposed the nudge unit. And we did the job properly because we warned people that French brainwashing experts, this is Oliver Willier from Sarkozy's private office, was working behind closed doors with the British government, literally to change the way the public thinks and behave. And it was only the UK column that put together the complex network of these individuals operating at the top of government. So that was up to David Cameron and, of course, Francis Maud with Gus O'Donnell. And let's highlight them here. So this is one cabal. This is the French team here. And together with Common Purpose, these people working behind closed doors, literally to change the way we think and behave. Here's Mark Easton, and this is a shot from his Twitter page. This is what he says, that he's home editor for BBC News and a pointless answer on pointless. Now, we're not too sure what that means. Gobbledygook, coded message, complete dross. I think I'm going to say Mark Easton, complete dross, like your article on nudging. And he knows nothing about the dangers at all. So how can we show the public what the dangers are? Well, let's have a look at this Breitbart article, which is talking about Sir Jeremy Haywood, top right. Of course, he took over from Sir Gus O'Donnell, who I've just mentioned, absolutely part of the applied behavioural psychology trial in the British government. How is the British government going to use this applied psychology to change the way we vote when we come up to deal with the European Union? So Breitbart warning, here comes the establishment. Britain's top unelected official demands government stitch up of EU vote. That references to Sir Jeremy Haywood. And what they're saying is this man is going to manipulate committees inside government to ensure the government gets the right vote over the EU, i.e. we are brainwashed to stay in. Highly dangerous subject, and Mr. Easton from the BBC completely missing the whole point, although he's supposed to be one of the key editors. If Mr. Easton doesn't believe us, we suggest he gets his nose into Mindspace. This is the government document in which it says people will have their views changed and they will not realise this will happen. What is the result of this dangerous type of manipulation? This is a UK column reporting that Devon and Cornwall police began to seek visions after they had received reframing training by Common Purpose. And this was the warning paragraph, mental reframing. Well, if reframing is the applied behavioural psychology, let's remember the type of people that want to direct our minds. Brilliant graphic, not sure where it came from. If you produced it, thank you very much, it's excellent. And what do they say to an image of Tony Blair and David Cameron? If you haven't figured it out by now, these are corporate spokesmen, not leaders. They both started illegal wars. They've been involved in the torture of people, bailed out criminal corporations, spied on you, violated your human rights, committed war crimes, tyrannised the poor and vulnerable, destroyed our economy, stolen our taxes while giving their rich friends tax breaks. What is it going to take to wake you up? Well, we're going to add to that is what is really scary is these are the men who can now implant their values in our minds without us realising it by the government's applied behavioural psychology unit. immensely dangerous people. And we know the technology works because the British government is now boasting that they've sold that technology to both the United States and Australia. Well, we will end there. Is the government in Britain covering up the abuse of children? Most certainly. Are British security services involved in the cover-up of the abuse of children? Most certainly. Are Britain's police involved? Most certainly. The problem is the paedophiles are embedded at the highest levels of the political establishment and elite in Britain. It's up to all of us to root them out. Can we do it with the likes of good people like Mickey Summers? We can, but at the end of the day, it requires all of us to take some action now. Thanks very much for joining us. We'll be back same time tomorrow. Bye-bye.